Call to order the city council work session for City of East Grand Forks for Tuesday, February 11th, 2020. It is now 5 o'clock. City clerk, please call roll.
Mayor Steve Gander, Council President Mark Olsted.
Here.
Council Vice President Chad Grassel.
Here.
Council members Clarence Vedder.
Here.
Dale Helms, Tim Riepel.
Here.
Tim Johnson.
Here.
Mark Demers.
Does term quorum number one, MNDOT Demers Avenue traffic light replacement and ADA work, Mr. Emery.
Thank you, Mr. President. So MnDOT has contacted us in regards to some traffic light replacement as well as some ADA work that they are planning for in 2024 along Demers Avenue, specifically at the intersections Demers Avenue and 2nd, and then also Demers Avenue and 4th Street. Any of the ADA work would be 100% MnDOT cost, any of that work that they need to do. But they are looking at, again, replacing both sets of traffic lights at those two intersections. They're estimating right now about $300,000 per traffic light for a total of $600,000. So the city's share of that would basically be one half or $300,000. So right now, I guess, you know, what MnDOT is kind of looking for from the city just to kind of keep moving forward with their project, too, is they're looking for a resolution, kind of, I guess, formally accepting, you know, approval that you'd be willing to, you know, cover your share of the project, too. So, and right now, we just kind of put in there for proposed funding, you know, being we are out there a ways. You know, you can either budget for the expense or utilize state aid funds. And I believe there we can use either construction or maintenance funds. Carla's not here right now. I don't know exactly what she's got in the maintenance fund account, but I did look in our construction account right now. We do have a balance of about $699,000. And I believe annually right now we got about into that construction account, we got about $460,000 that go in there annually. So with this project being out, you know, basically 3-4 years too, you know, that account balance, you know, will probably continue to grow unless we find other projects to use it for too. So I guess with that, if you have any questions for me.
Anybody have any questions, Mr. Demers?
Thank you. You started to touch on where I was going to go. Like the balance, you know, the $300,000 is going to come out of construction balance most likely. What other projects do we foresee? It has to be a state aid construction project?
It's got to be a project that's on our state aid street system. And I think we're going to have discussion, you know, sometime sooner than later, too. But in 2022, we do have our federal project coming again. Where, you know, there we receive about $860,000 in federal dollars. But there, too, if we do that project, you know, if we do a larger project, we'd be able to utilize these construction dollars for that, too. So
I guess I don't mind going ahead with this, but I would like to see, you know, maybe a 5-year plan of what we have coming up, you know, add those things. What are the state aid streets that we have issues on, or is there areas of town, you know, I know there's people that have wanted to get Reinhardt extended out, you know, further to the where the Hoses are, or where, what is that, Brandon Boulevard comes out,
yep,
connects in. I think there's people that would like to see that extended. I would imagine there's some other spots where we have state aid stuff. So I just, like, yep. I said, I think this is a good project. I just want to make sure that we're not putting $300,000 into something when we might have other needs. And
correct.
I think we should at least talk about that before we go.
Mr. Vedder.
Thank you. What kind of ADA improvements are they looking at?
I don't know exactly what they're looking at totally doing, because I mean Demers Avenue there, I mean, was redone not so terrible many years ago, so I don't know if, you know, just with some of the light replacements, if, you know, if they you know, I know like on 4th, I think with that light, they're going to have to redo the foundation and stuff, because that one that's on what I'd call the southwest corner there, you know, kind of by the BFW, that one always seems to get hit. So I know when they redo that, they'll, you know, be redoing the foundation and stuff, which, you know, then they're going to get into potentially some sidewalk work and stuff. But
my concern would be that when they're doing the ADA work, that they're keeping an eye to the snow removal, because it seems like they put the buttons to push for the walk across.
Oh, yep.
You always got them out in Timbuktu, and then you got to move snow around them, and it's just a,
yep,
would imagine a pain.
Yep.
So whatever they do to keep an eye towards snow removal, that make it easy as possible.
Yep.
Okay.
Anybody else have anything on that?
Didn't they, when they redid the street on 2nd, didn't they, in Demers, didn't they do something with those lights? Or am I missing out the point here?
I don't believe so, Mr. Russell.
No. So they tore up the street and then redid the street and then put the old lights back on?
I don't think they did anything with the traffic lights. They did, you know, they did put in the push button,
yep,
the APS systems and stuff, but I don't think they did anything with the traffic lights themselves, no.
Anybody else have anything? See none, sir. Thank you.
Okay.
Keep mindful of what we're going doing down the road, and
yep,
like Mr. Demers says, kind of just.
Yep.
Thank you, sir. Number two, MNDOT Highway 220 and 17th Street pedestrian improvements. Mr. Emery.
Thank you again. Again, MNDOT project on Highway 220. That they're looking at doing in 2022. And so specifically at the intersection of Highway 2 and 220, they're looking at making some pedestrian improvements at that intersection. And I did include kind of a drawing kind of from MnDOT too. So in the, it'd be the southwest quadrant of that intersection, they're looking at doing kind of curb bump out there just to minimize the distance kind of the pedestrians have to cross there. They'd also, in the center median, they'd be extending that center median so the pedestrians would kind of have a refuge where they would be able to stop, look for traffic, and not, you know, feel like that they got to cross that whole width of the street in one shot there. So, and then along with that, MnDOT is, I guess, kind of asking the city, too, if they want to kind of further enhance pedestrian safety there with putting in a rapid rectangular flashing beacon system, which would be similar to the systems that we have out on right now on Biglin and 13th Street out there. It's interesting, and I think myself, David, Jason, and Nancy, we had discussions with MnDOT, but if that's the direction the city wants to go, is MnDOT would pay for half of the initial installation, but then the city, once it's installed, the city would take over ownership of the beacon system as well as any future maintenance. So right now they're estimating the initial installation of it would be about $45,000, so the city share would be $22,500. Any of the work associated with the curb bump outs, ADA improvements at center median, that's picked up 100% by MnDOT. So I think, you know, really the biggest thing is there is, does the city feel that it's important up that crossing to, I guess, spend the additional or spend the money to, you know, maybe further enhance pedestrian improvements? In the Highway 220 corridor study that was just recently completed, they showed basically these improvements at the intersection, except they were just showing, you know, adding pedestrian signage type of stuff, not adding the flashing beacon system. So,
do we have a history of what those things cost for? for maintenance and upkeep? Because that one down south is only a, what, 2-year-old?
Yeah, that one's only a couple years old at this point. We did kind of ask that question. He did give me, you know, what the warranty systems are. You know, they were 3-year, they say limited battery warranty, 5-year limited system warranty, and then a 10-year limited solar panel warranty. You know, MNDOT did say that those systems are fairly maintenance-free. You know, they haven't had a lot of issues with the ones that are out there, but, and then one thing I should point out too, unlike our system out on Bigland and 13th, where we have a system on each side of the road, and then we have the one in the center median, with the width of this center median, they would not be able to put a flashing beacon system in the middle. So what they're looking at doing, which was kind of shown on the drawing here, is it would almost be like a regular traffic light pole with a mast arm, where they'd have a flashing beacon that would, you know, extend out, you know, above the traffic, just so it's more visible too. So again, that's a little bit too why it drives the cost up, you know, compared to even what the system we put it on in out on Bigland and 13th. So I guess open for discussion, you know, does the city wanna, I guess, invest the money to put in that beacon system, or, you know, do we just kind of, I guess, follow what the Bigland or Highway 220 corridor study showed, and, you know, just have MnDOT put in some additional signage and striping and that type of stuff. So,
Murphy,
I guess I just wanted to point out a little bit some of the discussions we did have as far as staff on those beacon arms that are out there, particularly the one I'll call it on the east side. You see where it shows where the pole is, and we do have some concerns that that might be an issue with snow removal. It's kind of out there. There's not really a good spot to put it out there that's out of the way. So I don't know if Jason wants to weigh in on that a little bit, but it's that one could be, because we do have issues with trying to keep that sidewalk open just when we do have heavy snow events, because you get the snow from the frontage road plus the highway as well.
Yeah, one of the other things we talked about was just ag equipment, making sure it could get through there when they put the bump outs in for the pedestrians, and they assured us that they would be looking at that, and the mast arms would be high enough. They'd be like a traffic light, so they would be able to get that equipment through there. And for, you know, it'd be MnDOT's, it's MnDOT's road to clear snow, but we still have to clear on the cross streets, you know, so I guess that's where our issues would come in there with
that. And you guys are still maintaining the sidewalk?
Yep, and the sidewalk, like Dave said, so that's where it gets to be a little difficult on our end.
Mr. Demers?
I guess I don't have a big problem with doing it. I think we want to improve traffic safety as much, or pedestrian safety as best we can. A couple of the questions I have are, if we own it and are subject to maintain it, if we decide to remove it, is that allowable? Or once it's in the state system, like, do we have to request to remove it? Like, say we 10 years down the road and we're like, this is not doing what we thought, do we have to, like, get permit to?
That's a good question. I'm not sure on that.
Or is there any standards that we have to maintain to? Like, sometimes I just want to make sure all the little
and those
threads
are,
get,
yeah, you
know, and those are hard to predict as well, as far as what the state rules are going to be 10 years from now for removing it. You
right.
know, that,
and
that
I
could
guess,
change it.
But as of now, I mean, that could be, is there a contract with that, or is that just, I mean, how does that get?
I don't know for 100%, but I would say that if we want to take them down, we probably could, because they're not requiring us to do this. This is just okay. More of a benefit for us if, as a city, if we'd like to go that route. So that would be my guess, that we could probably take them down since we do own them afterwards, and then, they're not required.
And then, like, say with snow removal, you do go through, or they go through and they blast them over, they hit something. I mean, is it going to be us, or are they going to take responsibility for it if it's them?
I would think they would have to take responsibility.
If you could prove it was them.
Yeah.
Well, they all got GPS and cameras on their planes and stuff, right? I guess I would, I don't mind doing it. I just would like to see maybe some of those type of things written down so we have an agreement and then go forward from there. Go.
Russell?
My worry is the one on the east side that is close to the road. How many times that thing is going to get hit and run over on that corner? I mean, even with a truck trying to make that turn.
The way it sounds is that they'll be set back quite far, the arms.
Yeah, you know, the pole isn't going to be set back.
Yeah, the pole will be set back. Out of the way is the way that they described it to us, because we asked if farm machinery came through there. You know, the tires might fit on the road, but the equipment might stick out over the edge of the road.
Right.
And they said that there would be enough room to accommodate that. So I, you know, will it get hit? It might get hit, but
you were talking about the one on the east side, though.
Right, coming, making that close turn.
Yep.
You're just saying how close that pole is to the end of,
right,
to where the bump out, or
they're redoing these bump outs too, right?
Yeah. So in the map that they show there, yeah.
Oh, on.
I mean, and I'm not against it, but I mean, in engineering today, there's got to be a way that you can put that pole on the other side of the sidewalk, away from that corner, and engineer something to go some direction.
Or could you put it on the north side of the intersection? I mean, if you're going to have traffic come and want to, well, I guess you want to have it on the south side on there.
Yeah, I think you want it on the south side, because you go
turn.
As you go east on 17th there, I mean, the sidewalk's on the south side. And then even on the west side at 220 there, all the sidewalk is pretty much on the south side. So
I think that's something we could probably suggest, Jen.
I mean, just, yeah.
Anybody else have any questions on that?
I guess I kind of do.
Mr. Johnson.
Steve, what? Where are we at with these roundabouts? What? I mean, this is for the 2022, this particular 17th. But where are we at with the roundabouts and on 14th and 23rd? Was it 22nd?
I think it was actually 17th and 23rd, yeah, is what the study showed. We did have some discussion about that yesterday, and I think that was kind of a long term. I think we were thinking like 15, 20 years out is kind of what we were thinking.
So Mr. Demers is not online with his 10-year thing. That this could be history in short time. This if we do this on 17th.
Right.
Thank you.
Anybody else have anything? Thank you, Steve. Appreciate it.
Yep.
Number three, request to purchase niche columbarium for Resurrection Cemetery.
Thank you, Mr. President, Council. So in the budget for 2020, we've got $40,000 set aside for a niche columbarium. Last fall, at our November Cemetery Commission meeting, we had the commissioners take a look at designs that would match the two most recent columbariums that have been purchased for the cemetery, one in 2010 and the second one in the fall of 2016. This columbarium that was chosen by the commission is larger than the other two that are there. Those are 48 niche columbariums. The one that they selected, this one's a 120 niche columbarium. So it could fit 120 urns essentially inside this one. So just looking for approval to purchase that. The couple just extra comments or notes for you on it is the two that are there now, the 2010 columbarium is full. It's completely sold out. The one that was purchased in the fall of 2016 is about 65% sold right now. And we're seeing roughly burials, it's about 62 to 64% of burials now are cremation burials, rather they be full burials or cremains buried even in the ground. But well more than 50% are going to cremation. So this is one that we're seeing even more and more purchase in this way as time goes. So I think it'd be prudent of us to get this purchased and installed this summer so that we continue to have an option for people that want to go into that. With all of that said, just yesterday at a department head meeting, I was unaware. I was confused on the purchasing rules. This is the only price you see in front of you, of course, is this just this columbarium. That was done because it's kind of a specific piece, and the design of it is specific to the style that we have at the cemetery. Yesterday at the department head meeting, Mr. Galstead and Ms. Anderson both felt that we still need to have a second price before we can go ahead with the purchase because the material is more than $25,000. So it may not be, if you all are want to move forward, I may not have it ready to put onto the council agenda next week because I'll have to do some work to find a similar product. I made a few phone calls today, and the pricing, this is certainly priced lower than the phone calls I made today, but they're not similar products either. So I want to get back together with Mr. Galstead, Ms. Anderson even, and figure out, because it's such a specific product and a specific design, if we can't find one that matches it to be able to get a comparable quote. I haven't done a lot of work on that through the day today, but just so you're all aware, it may not be ready for next week's council meeting.
Okay. Anybody have any questions? See none. Thank you, sir. Number four, discussion on community forums regarding recreation facility improvements.
Okay. Thank you again. So kind of a three-part conversation with this one. Number one, I guess the resolution and the support materials, we confirmed that they were received prior to the January 31st deadline with the state. We had some conversation with Senator Johnson and Representative Keel before they went down to the Capitol. So they're aware of all of the information as it stands today and kind of what the resolution passed, and are aware that it was received by the appropriate tax committees. We have not, since session started today, we have not reached out today or heard back from anybody on the status of that down there, but we know that they have it and we'll review it. So that's a quick update. Subsequent with that, then, we've scheduled tentatively some community input sessions. Number one, the first one being, that one is scheduled with a time and date of February 20th. That would be at the Civic Center, beginning at 5:30 p.m. and leading up till 7 p.m., which is the start time of a boys' high school hockey game that evening at the arena. So that'd be the first place. That will be very much an informational session where we will have information about the proposed projects that are being discussed, the sales tax, kind of what the resolution was passed for, some of the tax impact that may have to a resident or to a consumer as they make purchases in the community. And then we'll have some postcards available for people to be able to fill out and provide feedback, some questions on maybe likes or dislikes about the current idea. And just generally an area for them just to give us some feedback via a postcard, whether they want to discuss that with us personally or they want to do it anonymously. They would have the option to do both. So that'd be the number one. That one is for sure set for that evening. Our Parks and Recreation staff will be on site to help with that. Ms. Anderson said she would be able to be there to help answer any questions people would have. And certainly I'd love to make it available for all of you and with any of you, however you want to be involved. If you're willing and able, we'd love to have you participate as well. The three dates following that, the March, April, and June dates, are all still very tentative at this point. We would like to get them scheduled, firmly scheduled sooner than later, so that we have them posted and available for people to see them and know that they're going to take place and where they're going to take place. But I wanted for those ones to make sure we could get them all in front of you. If you see any conflicts or scheduling purposes, have any input for potential locations, anything you guys want to see out of it, to please feel free to share that with us tonight. So that'd be the number one, the dates on that. And then the next part of it would be, I put a list of potential stakeholders in front of you. A couple of you before the meeting started mentioned a few more that maybe were missed, but this I see as kind of a working document at this point of potential user groups or interested parties, organizations, businesses in the community that we should specifically reach out to at these community forums, make sure that they know when they're happening, make sure they're invited. Certainly, all of our residents in our community I would look at as a stakeholder for these projects, but these could be very specific targeted stakeholders. And taking it a next step further is if we would like to see any type of formation of a focused task force or a steering committee, whether that be for the sales tax projects as a whole, to oversee or kind of give input to the whole project, everything that we're discussing from a sales tax perspective, or even there's potential you could take it a step further, and if you wanted to see focused user groups, perhaps for the arenas could be a focus group, the ball fields could be a focus group, the Lefebvre Park and Greenway improvements could be a focus group, because you're going to get kind of a array of differing thoughts and opinions from all those groups and potential for design and what kind of money to spend and how important it is and all those aspects. So a lot to put in front of you there, but just more looking for any feedback or discussion you all have on how you'd like to see that move forward from this point on.
Do you have any feedback for Mr. Reid right now? I think with your advisory group, you have a lot of some of the groups involved. And I know you mentioned that you're going to have the first meeting on February 20th. My thought would be that to help maybe get these other groups and other groups you add to this list to attend, maybe a location and a time that would be beneficial to all of them. Mm-hmm. You're going to have all the hockey people come to the game.
Yeah.
Which is going to probably be your most attentive group right now, because that's the biggest project.
Right. And that was the intent, sorry to interrupt, but the intent of having it still was to try to do the best we could to catch our skating and hockey community while the season's still in swing and we know that we're going to have a crowd in one place.
I mean, I would think you'd look, I don't know, if you wait another month after the first one, I'm thinking maybe that's too long.
Okay.
I mean, because you got to remember, too, that we have to have what this decided by beginning of August. I think that maybe there's too much time gap to keep things rolling, because you can wait a whole month and all of a sudden, where are we at? You're gathering and you're trying to say, okay, what did we learn from last month and all this? Then you're going another month. And then maybe I'm wrong, but I think that's maybe you're going too long in between.
Okay.
I guess I have one more statement. I've heard lots of things about this project, and the one thing that's kind of concerning to me is that we're just throwing this together as a quick project and throwing all of it together and trying to hurry up and push it through. This has been in discussion for years. Since the last time we met strategically, it came up for strategic planning within the city, and doing something different with our arenas was one aspect. We always knew that our parks needed some updating. We always knew that the greenway was going to be an issue, and recently, I guess the thing that's come to the forefront the most is the system down at Lefebvre Park. That is the one that we kind of know came fast, but there's lots of things being said on the radio. There's lots of things being printed in the paper that we're kind of pushing this through. And I just wanted to make sure that the people out there, this isn't just like we thought about this last Wednesday and we're going to do it. There's been a lot of process or things that went through for this process. So that's all I got to say.
Mr. Vedder.
Thank you. What I'd be interested in is, like, after your February 20th one, and you got mostly the hockey crowd is going to be at that one, but then our next work session, to do an overview of that, but at the same time invite, like, the Blue Line representatives, maybe the figure skating representatives, just to gather their input at one of our work sessions.
Okay.
Maybe even arts and crafts, because they're utilizing those, whoever is utilizing those buildings.
Sure.
To invite them to our work session then to say, you know, poll your members, see what you want, bring it to the work session, because we're going to discuss this specific project.
Okay.
And then the same thing a month later or the next work session, if we're talking about Lafayette Park, then you invite the Catfish Club and whoever else is going to be using that, so that we as this group can gather all the information.
Okay.
Anybody else have any? Mr. Demers.
Thank you. I did discuss with Mr. Huttunen today that I don't know if it has to be one of the other dates, the 19th, 21st, or 18th, or, but I do think, and it was added on here, the business leaders, owners, I think, you know, working with Barry and the chamber to set up an event with business people, you know, in town, you know, have them be the sponsor of something like that, and then we can get there and talk to them about what's going on, I think would be an important thing too, just to kind of.
Couldn't we do that at business after hours? Be it.
I don't know.
Because there's an awful lot of them there.
You could. I think it warrants its own issue.
That's what they use that event for, though. You know, to have another event within the event. You might want to talk to them, but I don't think that that's something that they.
Right. I just think this warrants a direct conversation on this matter with our business community, and I would bet that Barry would be willing to try to get people together. I mean, it's good for them to get people together. It's good for the city to try to get people together, talk, and try to organize something that we can do. Like I said, there's never going to be a great time to do it, but I think. I don't know. And like, I understand the idea is like, if there already is a bunch of people coming to an event, try to capture that. But like I said, I don't know if that'll work. Talk to Barry about it.
You can even maybe hold it up on the arenas or, you know, and
what, yeah,
show them physically what's going on. You know. Anybody else have any input for that?
Well, then the only other thing that I would say is, again, for instance, Reid or someone's office contacted iHeartRadio talking about the wild promotion for the boards. I've heard that thing I don't know how many times on the radio. I am sure they would do something similar for this regarding an East Side meeting, because it's a public nonprofit event.
Right.
And I don't know, I've heard it on three different radio stations over the last few days. That's probably more important than getting the word out than just putting out a flyer or an email or even putting it in the next one.
The only follow-up question I would have then is on the fundraising aspect of it. I didn't touch on that earlier, but it's one of the discussion points is Mayor Gander and I, he couldn't be here, of course, but he and I visited last week for a pretty lengthy amount of time about fundraising for projects like this. And I guess, how does the council, how would you like to see that proceed? You know, going back to, is it a task force of community members that help us through that process? Is it, do we look to consult with somebody for that kind of work? Have you put any thought into that as a group, even strategically? What's our fundraising goal? You know, and maybe you don't have the answers tonight, but something to think about for a work session in a couple of weeks is, I think it's we subsequent with all the potential design conversations we need to have a really strategic conversation with our community members and our user groups about what do we think our fundraising capacity is in the community, how much can we make on that, how much can we make on naming rights and so forth, you know, because all of that's going to play a big part in what this sales tax number ends up at. I think
that's part of your, you know, meetings you have, you know, the first one too, that's got to be a part of that, you know, information that's given out. You know, this is going to be an effort, community effort, that we have to do.
But what I think he's looking at is you're willing to hire a consultant. If you guys are cutting this thing down.
I know what he's asking for, but.
You know, $12 million on a thing, you're going to have to come up with $18 million.
Yeah, but my question, and yes, when we worked through the pool, we used Community Foundation. And, I mean, I know that you've been approached by a private person that does it. My question is, what fee do they charge and what are we going to?
Yeah.
They do a lot of great work. I get it. But what is the cost?
Just know, be clear that I'm not asking you guys to approve hiring a fundraising consultant. That's not my approach to this. I'm asking you if that's something that there's an appetite to do. I have not asked for any information or fee or anything. So just to be clear there.
Thank you. I guess I think we as a group needed to come up with what number we think we're happy with, you know, or where we, what's our goal? You know, if we know we want to spend, if we come up with $30 million and we want, is it 10% or is it, you know, is it 15%? Pick that number and then back it out. And then we can decide, are we going to allocate that to all these different groups and give them each a number that they have to hit? Or are we going to be the fundraising group? You know, I mean, because if we just pass this out and say, we expect you guys to fundraise this much above and beyond what you are now and hit those targets, that'll take someone, a champion from within the city, whether it's someone that's paid or on staff right now, to organize and stay on top of that, because you see how many stakeholders we got right now. I mean, if we're going to ask something from each of those, that's going to be a big wrangle, you know. And if we're going to, but if we're just going to do it ourselves and we're going to do all the fundraising, that's a whole, I don't know if anybody's got that. We don't have a person on staff that is dedicated to that, to raising that type of thing. But back to my point is I think we need to just come up with our expectation of what we feel needs to come from like the private side fundraising effort, you know, above and beyond what the status is right now. And once we do that, then you can kind of back out and figure out how you want to allocate the responsibility. You know, I don't think you, because if we just say, well, we're not going to do any fundraising, which I don't think anybody does, but if we're not going to do that, well, then why have the discussion? If we're only going to ask people to raise $100,000, then I don't think it's as big a deal. But if we are going to ask for 10% or 15% of the cost, then I think we need to get serious about how that organization looks. Because everybody that does fundraising knows if you don't have accountability and someone that champions it, like a full-time gig on these big things, it's not going to happen. It just, the dollars don't flow like that.
Anybody else have anything to offer? Suggestions? Anything else you need?
Good for now.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Number five, update on quiet zone survey. Mr. Murphy.
Thank you, Council President. I just wanted to bring this up. We have had, it's been, say, roughly about a month now since the survey question, or the letter went out asking for responses about the quiet zone for the neighborhood. We did send letters to all people that were within 1,000 feet, or I guess all property owners that were within 1,000 feet of the potential closure, and asked for their input. If the number escapes, I believe it was a little more than 100 letters went out, and I received two back. So. As undeliverable, so I think we had a pretty good success rate for getting them through there. Of that, the responses that I did receive, I put together and gave you a copy of that tonight. I think we have about 17 responses out of that, say roughly 100 that went out. Of that, we had one strong no, that they didn't want to see the third closed, wanted to keep that open. Otherwise, the remainder were yes, or one. We did receive one response that didn't really care either way whether it stayed open or it closed. Didn't seem to mind the whistles. One unknown response. I
wasn't quite sure what they were at, what their response was. And then two were, which were yes with conditions. And the one that with conditions that I would like to really highlight is the one that I received from the Sacred Heart Church, a representative from them, I believe by the name of Shelley Johnson. Her concern, and I think she speaks for the education part of it. I don't believe she speaks for the church as a whole, but it was getting the kids across to where that swing set is, and that little playground is on the, I'll say, on the south side of the tracks. In my conversation with her, I don't believe that it was a deal breaker that she would not support the closure if that did not happen. But I think she wants to keep that in mind and make sure that we have probably the best, shortest access available to there and safe access. She was very adamant about that as well. So even if they have, if the children have to walk a little bit longer, if it's a safe access and the train whistles can be done away with, I believe that it would still have her support. So I guess with that, I'll take any questions that the council may have on this. I guess what I'm looking for is, based on the responses, it seems like of the ones that did respond, it's an overwhelming support for moving forward with closing that. So if the council's okay with that, then I would just like direction from the council for staff to take the next step with the railroad and start drafting a potential agreement for this to be brought back for council action.
Can I just clarify? So a yes response is for closing
for closing
the street,
it. Yep,
but is it assumed that everybody is in favor of the quiet zone? I mean, so it wasn't a quiet zone issue. It was just for the closing of the street issue.
Well, the letter was drafted saying that we could get the quiet zone and the railroad would pay for a majority of it if they were allowed to close that Third Street access. So the question was, are you in favor of a quiet zone if even if it requires the closure of Third Street?
Okay. And that, so it was contingent on that.
Yeah. Okay. And the one no, he just, I guess, likes the history of it and the sound of the whistle.
Maybe a follow-up informational to the council, too, what the breakdown on getting cost was. You know, it's been a while. I don't remember what it was. I mean, so you don't have to do it now. Maybe you can send it out, maybe so that we know what that would be. And, you know, next time, yeah, start the process, I guess, in my mind with, you know, BNSF and go through that. And then maybe send it out an email what the costs were and, you know, maybe at the next work session. Walk through it with us again.
Great.
Is everybody fine with that? Mr. Emery?
Yeah, and one thing we have to just be aware of, and we'll have to visit with MnDOT on that too, because Third Street there right now is currently on our state aid system. So, you know, closing that crossing, you know, kind of, let's say, almost losing that connection from the north side of the tracks to the south side tracks, you know, that potentially will affect just our kind of our overall state aid system. So that's something just kind of
Because they don't like dead end streets. They don't want dead end streets to be on the state aid system. Yeah. But I think that's something that I think we can work with them on this issue.
Definitely, yeah. Just want to make you aware of that. That's just
Third Street all the way to Second, or how far? Is that how it goes?
It goes all the way up to, well, basically up to Demers Avenue, all the way down Third, and then it's at Hill Street it kind of hits, and then it goes east all the way over to
Central Avenue,
or Biglin, or
Second.
Yeah, thank you.
Yep.
Anybody else, Mr. Murphy? See none. Entertain a motion to adjourn. Moved by Vedder.
Second
by Riopel. Any questions or discussion for that? Really? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion is carried. Means adjourned.
I suppose you can't make Hill Street.
You couldn't. It would close here, right?